Carpenter's Hall, this is Site Philadelphia, just down the street. 12 colonies will meet there for the first Continental Congress in 1774. And they decide here that Parliament has the right to make the laws, but they don't have a right to tax the colonies. But after the battles of Lexington and Concord in spring of 1775, representatives from 13 colonies meet here for the Second Continental Congress. Now folks, this is where they're going to authorize the Continental Army, June 14th. That happens to be Flag Day, by the way. Now, there are several veterans here of the French and Indian War. Only one, though, decides to wear his military uniform. They need to choose a commander. Who do you want to reckon that was? George Washington. You think he's sending a message to these guys? It's like, I'm ready to go. Send me. Woo! He's not that kind of a guy, though. You know, he's a little more tamer than I am. But yeah, they choose him. He goes up to Massachusetts. You will not see his name on the declaration. Now, these men do reach out to their king one last time. They are looking to him to be a referee in this debate between Parliament and the colonies with the olive branch petition. The king, though, he's got another viewpoint on the subject. He's like, you are treasonous against me. You're disloyal. Conversation's over. So then the next two military branches are authorized, the Air Force and the Army.
Air Force,
Navy, and then the Marine Corps. All right. Now, 1776 comes around. I'm originally from North Carolina. One of the dates on our flag is of the Halifax Resolves. So this colony said, we're going to go ahead and do it. We are declaring ourselves independent from England. Please join us, though. I don't know how this colony thought they were going to take on the military of England by themselves, but there you go. But it's Richard Henry Lee of Virginia who will propose his independence resolutions. So we call for the formal break. The Committee of Five is formed to work on the Declaration. Another idea he had is recycled from the Seven Years' War. It was an idea this man, who designed America's first political cartoon, designed. Who was that?
Ben Franklin.
All the Union during the French and Indian War, he had the idea that these colonies need to form a national government. It was not popular, so you'll see this come up again. During the War for Independence, our first government being the Articles of Confederation and Perpetual Union. Now, think of this, folks. 13 colonies taking on one of the most powerful, well-funded militaries in the world. Can they do that and sustain this for a while? No. Think of this. I mean, much like the war in 2019, you do need a lot of the same things. Munitions, ships, a ton of money, manpower. Little bit of a controversial idea. Reach out to monarchs and see if any of them wants to go to war against our king. Some people had their doubts about this because France was our enemy a hot minute ago. Now, before some of these gentlemen leave to go to Europe, they're going to help Mr. Jefferson write that declaration. And I can't find the version that I want. But I'll bring this version now because that's a good one too. Now, Declaration, worked on by five men. Jefferson's representing the southern colonies, but from New England, you also have John Adams and Roger Sherman from the Mid-Atlantic, Benjamin Franklin, and Robert Livingston. So they're all working on this document. And on the 2nd of July, these resolutions are adopted here, and then the Committee of Five present the Declaration. And they spend 2 days going over it, making many changes. Finally, on the 4th, most states vote to adopt the Declaration. Now, you can see one of these declarations printed on the 4th, the Dunlap broadside. It was read right back here on the square on July 8th. It's next door in the West Wing. This version, though, comes out 6 months later, printed by a woman in Baltimore, Maryland. She is the first printer to print the declarations with the signers' names. And that'll be the first time, January 1777, that the signers' names are made public. All right. Now, when you read the Declaration, and I do urge you to do so when you have some time, oh my gosh, they go on and on and on. They call the king a tyrant, unfit to be the ruler of a free people. He has cut off our trade with all parts of the world. He's quartered large bodies of armed troops among us. He has kept us among us in times of peace, standing armies without the consent of our legislatures. 27 complaints against the king. Just one refers to taxation without representation. Now, the more famous version you see in the archives, that was signed here about a month after July 4th. They start signing it August 2nd, right here in this room. Now, folks, There's a lot of great things in this document, but it's one thing to write about freedoms and liberties and quite another to fight for these ideals. This war lasted 8 years. It was fought by people who were rich, poor, free, enslaved, African American, European American, indigenous people, Hispanic people. If they have not secured these liberties for us, this means nothing. It's just a piece of paper with pretty writing on it. Even the gentleman who wrote this version, Timothy Matlack, he was born and raised a Quaker. He was shunned by his family, his religious community, but he started a free Quaker movement and supported the revolution, and he served in the army. Now we are going to send diplomats to Europe. Benjamin Franklin, he's charming everybody in Paris. John Jay, John Adams goes over, Silas Dean, one of the Lees, there's a lot of them, I get them all confused. What European countries come to our assistance?
France,
they get a lot of love from us. Last year was the 240th anniversary of the French-American Alliance. They gave us ships, troops, loans, munitions, all kinds of stuff. And then they will bring in their very powerful ally. Who's that? Spain. Yes, the kings were related, plus both countries have real estate in this part of the world too, so it makes sense. If anybody hears from the west or southwest United States, that impacted those areas. Those Native Americans and colonists were taxed directly to fund our war. 35,000 Puerto Rican troops get shipped up here to fight. That's from the Department of Defense website. Holland, I don't know, maybe they didn't want to get their hands dirty, but they're like, John Adams, we're going to make it rain. Here's four loans. There you go. Go fight. And then we will make Native American alliances too, notably the Oneida and the Tuscarora, and indigenous to Pennsylvania, some of the Lenape people. And then men of noble birth are coming here. An example is right out here on Chestnut Street. This is one of our newest national park trails, the Washington Rochambeau Revolutionary Route. It goes all the way from Boston down to Yorktown, Virginia. You're halfway there. Get to marching, all right? That'll be the huge victory that swings it to our side. But there's one young man, 19 years old, and he defied the King of France's orders and came here anyway. I bet you some of the students could tell me who he is. He's known as America's most favorite fighting Frenchman in a very popular musical right now. Lafayette. He was inspired by the Declaration of Independence. 230 years ago, he writes the Declaration of the Rights of Man and Citizen with Thomas Jefferson's help. Now, folks, we will be briefly occupied by the British Army. And then afterward, the Confederation Congress is meeting here. And some of these guys were veterans of the Continental Army. And they had witnessed firsthand the weaknesses of the Confederation government. People like Hamilton, he's now a member of Congress, formerly Secretary to General Washington. And he had been constantly writing to Congress about getting supplies for the army. Now, he's going to see it from the other side, though. And finally, some of these soldiers had had it. 400 of them show up one day and surround the building we're standing in. And they demand their money. Hamilton was sent out to negotiate with these guys. They didn't want to hear it. They chased Congress out of Philadelphia, and they end up in New York City at the end of the war. Ladies and gentlemen, students, 8 years of revolution was ended by the Treaty of Paris in 1783. General George Washington will voluntarily step down from the most powerful position in the country, not President of the United States. That does not exist yet. Commander-in-Chief. He could have led a military coup. Some people were calling for him to be a king. But he steps down, he's a private citizen once again. Hear that, Napoleon Bonaparte? Should have learned history, just saying. All right, now, I will be very, very honest with you. This country was a mess after the war. These states are deeply in debt. They owe on those foreign loans. I read you the line about standing armies in the Declaration. They had a big fear of that. They got rid of most of the military. Just a few army kept, no Navy, no Marine Corps. Students, who likes to attack ships? Pirates. Barbary pirates from Northern Africa seize on this opportunity and attack our commercial ships. They're holding Americans for ransom. Spain, our neighbor, is now looking at us like, maybe we can take advantage of the situation these new guys are in. And then the Confederation. Each state got one vote. Each state is run by their own president or governor. Each state is printing their own currency. To change anything about the Confederation, it had to be almost unanimous approval. So Hamilton and Madison are going to be the prime guys organizing the Constitutional Convention here in Philadelphia in 1787, at first to correct some of the weaknesses. But then something happens. There's a new government born in this room. Now, folks, I'll put this question to you. Does Congress get along today?
No.
I'm a lot of optimism. Do they represent different interests?
Yes.
Absolutely. 232 years ago, same thing is happening. These people are lawyers. Actually, a lot of lawyers meeting here. You have soldiers. You have abolitionists. You have wealthy slave owners, plantation owners, including the gentleman presiding over the convention, General George Washington. There are fiery discussions and debates happening in this room over how to run this new country that's been fought so hard for. But at the end of it all, they do build this three-branch system of government: judicial, legislative, executive. Each branch keeping an eye on each other, checks and balances. The way you choose the leader of the country, fiercely argued. Hamilton was all for letting the executive serve for life. These guys were like, calm down, buddy, we just got away from that. Let's try something fresh. Now, House, Senate, and then compromises made in this room too, at the expense of some people's liberties and freedoms. Now, this figure I'm holding up is an enlargement of the figure that's on that chair that General Washington sat in, and Benjamin Franklin was asked about this toward the end. Is this rising? This is setting. And his famous answer is, I now have the happiness to know it is indeed a rising and not a setting sun. The Constitution is signed in this small room, September 17, 1787. But folks, just like these men could predict the outcome of the revolution, they're not to know of the effects of the decisions they're making here, how they will change people's lives over the course of our history. There are lots of examples, but we don't have time to go over all of them. One of them, though, is this. Next year, the National Park Service nationwide will be commemorating, not celebrating, the centennial of the 19th Amendment. Folks, women have been fighting in almost every single war on this soil, serving either in the military, maybe known, maybe covertly, maybe serving as nurses or in the camps. Every war on the soil, pretty much. Yet largely denied the vote until the 19th Amendment was passed in 1920. But did that give all women a vote? No. And in some cases, many women of color will be denied the vote for many, many years afterward until the Voting Rights Act was passed in 1965. Folks, what's important to keep in mind, these men, despite their flaws, and they are human, they are flawed like we are flawed, they come together and build this living government, and that is what's so special and unique about the Constitution. And I urge you, if you're a U.S. citizen, take some time. Read the Declaration of Independence, read the Constitution, go beyond the preamble we all had to memorize in school. These men built a legacy. It's up to us, the American citizen, to continue and build upon their work. And folks, democracy can be a very fragile thing. You have to work hard to protect it. So learn the history of your country, know your government, know your rights, and vote. Thank you for your time.